Between the time when the oceans drank Sindarin and the rise of the Sons of Elrond, there was an age undreamed of. And unto this Kuros, destined to battle the evil Malkil throughout the ages, it is I, his chronicler, who alone can tell thee of his saga. Let me tell you of the days of wizards and warriors. We begin our tale in the forests of Elrond. My master was tasked with the near impossible feat of rescuing the captive damsels, as well as his own beauteous princess. Somehow, he would have to climb the ominous Castle Ironspire. There, the evil wizard Malkil, whose magic is so great Merlin called him teacher, awaits for their first battle.
Wizards and Warriors. That brings me back to the days when I was a little kid when that came out. I think the first one came out back in 1987. So I was only 3 years old. I was too young to even play these games. I didn't start gaming until I was four. But so I was a little bit later, but between the ages of 8 and 10 when I actually finally played this series. And oddly enough, I actually first played the third one and then went back progressively playing each one.
So the first time that I had ever played Wizards and Warriors back in the day, probably around 1990 or 91, we'd always rent it at a local corner store, all our NES games, and me and my brother had come upon a title called Wizards and Warriors. It'd be a cool little game to play.
One of the most nostalgic games for me, although I never owned it as a kid, that is because of how I first played it, and I'll never forget this. A buddy of mine at school lent it to me on a Friday, so I got to check out this brand new game for a whole weekend, which was awesome when we were kids, right? And I grew up with two older siblings, so I was pretty much never left alone. My time alone was very scarce. But I remember that particular night, they were both out doing something. It just felt like the whole house was empty, and I was up in my room. Door was shut, lights were off, and I was just like getting lost in this new game.
Wizards and Warriors 1, stellar game, first entry into the series, what would be a shorter series, but it's a great little action platformer, and at the time, the music is incredible.
It had that awesome music, it was really adventurous and had a catchy ring to it, with all the bleeps and bloops. I'm a big fan of the days of bleeps and bloops music from video games, especially the level 1 theme. It had a very recognizable theme. Boop, 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 boop.
You've got Kuros, who's trying to save the various damsels of the realm and is trying to save his princess that's been locked up.
And he showed me this Wizards and Warriors, and it was just such a cool looking game, especially that box art. If you look at the box art, it had this big brawlic barbarian looking dude attacking some beasts on it. So it was just so cool. It really made you want to play that game.
And I loved the level design. I loved the colors of it. I loved the map, you know, the way that the levels connected.
Yeah, right away, it really sucks you in, into the forest level and inside trees even. And you're making your way because they have this huge map.
of course, the setting with the castle and everything. And the music was amazing. Some of my favorite music to this day, actually. And I just had such a ball. It was just so, it's so nostalgic for me because of that memory. And because of the leniency, the Unlimited continues, I actually finished the game, which was icing on the cake. I mean, when we were kids, beating a game was everything.
I call this the hopping game because it was a side-scrolling platformer, but you were basically just hopping all along throughout the levels. You would hop from one platform to the next, progressively going up, which that was really cool because you didn't just go, you know, all the way to the right. You would actually hop up in the air and progress that way. And I remember as you'd jump up, you'd have this annoying spider who would just drop down from the top and it would just attack you. And that always got us all the time. We just fall down and it would kill us all the time.
So yeah, the jumping mechanics I don't want to say floaty, but it's kind of slippery, a little bit loose, but once you get used to it, it's not that bad. Generally you want to power yourself up and use like a ranged attack, like the throwing dagger or the throwing axe, because using just straight up swordplay is not, you're not going to have a fun time. It's a little bit tricky, a little bit off.
The attack was never that great. You didn't have any kind of reach with your attack. You had this little sword that you kind of swung, and it was just better just to jump up into the enemy or hope that they just fly into your sword randomly.
So, I mean, it's like this big, huge adventure, and you're getting all these cool weapons. You're finding all these chests to unlock, right? Like the like the Cloak of Darkness. I remember that my older brother, Derek, when we'd ever pick up this game and we'd always find the Cloak of Darkness. He'd always say, and the Cloak of Darkness. So, that always stuck out.
Wizards and Warriors 1 was a great game developed by Rare. It was a great jumping off point for a new franchise with a medieval theme. It's definitely a great game that you should pick up and play. It's one that I want to go back and revisit because it brought us a lot of joy as a child. And there's great, fond memories of that game.
So I just remember that memory so strongly with this game, and that's why I just keep going back to it throughout my adult life, just because it brings me back to that night and just kind of getting lost with my imagination in that game. And yeah, it's awesome.
So you got the whole wizard and the warrior thing going.
My dearest, it has been a month since you whisked me into your arms and saved me from my prison. I can still feel the thundering of my heart against your armor, but tell me the rumors of you are not true. I overheard the peasants speaking of a Kuros inside a tavern called the Naughty Damsel. They said this man was drinking and shouting foul language. Oh, tell me it was someone else and not you. I know you would not do those things because, my future husband, if you had, I would have to bludgeon thee with my scepter. Hungrily yours, Princess Joanne.
Ah, the sweet taste of victory. The deeds of my master Kuros have now spread far and wide across the land. We drown our knights in tales as bombastic as the wizards and dragons he slew. So it was not uncommon when we received a message of help. The realm of Sindarin was in danger. Malkil has returned with the power of the elements on his side. Only the magical weapon, the Iron Sword, can defeat him now.
Wizards and Warriors 2, Iron Sword.
So Wizards and Warriors 2, Iron Sword, is actually a curious case because me and Will, actually, of the three, this was the last game that we got of the trilogy, so the nostalgia glasses are pretty dim on this one.
This game, man, never played it as a kid, thankfully. Saw it in Nintendo Power, thought it looked cool. I don't even know how I ended up with it in my collection, but I have it. Threw it in a couple years ago to check it out, see if I could do something with it. And started off pretty optimistic, honestly. It looks great. It's a huge graphical upgrade from the first game, which is kind of grainy, to be honest.
Though this one was a much more polished-looking game. It was a bigger game, there was more exploring. Again, you were going around finding treasure, collecting keys and gems.
So the first time I played Wizards and Warriors 2, I did not like the game because right at the beginning, from the get-go, you're at the bottom of the mountain, and all of these creatures just swarm you. They come and they try to just totally annihilate you.
But my optimism crumbled very quickly in the second half of the first level in the clouds. I mean, I'm getting killed. You gotta get killed in these games generally, but this game just feels different. The damage, I still do not understand the damage in this game. I can have full health, walk into a cave, get hit by a Teletubby twice, and I'm dead.
So, I never beat the game personally myself. Whereas I think I only beat Wizards and Warriors, but number two is extremely difficult.
And the game started you off, you were very weak at the beginning. You didn't have this helmet. Your character sprite kind of looked like this goofy looking dude.
The graphics are actually, I kind of like the graphics, although Kuros kind of looks a little bit funky without his helmet on. It's kind of stupid looking.
I do remember the cover art. Fabio was on the cover. Fabio with no shirt, long flowing blonde hair, holding the big sword. I mean, come on. You had to play this game. I mean, women adored him and men wanted to be him.
So you're trying to find various magic spells that'll actually help defeat the four elements. Malkiel has kind of separated himself into the four elements, you know, the wind, earth, fire and water, or is it water? Yeah, it's probably water. But anyways, it's kind of like Captain Planet kind of thing going on.
You would get these golden artifacts that you would give to the animal king of each level, and they would take you to get some spell. And that spell would have a weakness against the boss fight for that level, which that was really cool.
Music is awesome. Some of the best title screen music you're going to hear on the NES.
And the music, they really improved upon on that music. You know, I love that title theme. I'm a big fan for opening title themes. When you have that, those bleeps and bloops in the music, there's something about that.
So yeah, number two is, it's really, the best thing about number two is the music, because the music, again, is fantastic.
There weren't really a lot of things that I disliked about the second game. I mean, it had pretty much everything from the first, but just improved upon. I would argue that, again, the attack really isn't the best. That might be a little bit worse. It just didn't have that lack of range. The hitbox wasn't really perfect.
But it's really good, and the commercial was awesome. I actually remember the commercial as a kid. So, you know, with Kuros and the little kid in the bedroom.
Come on! Almost! Finally! Yeah!
Triumph is ours!
But the battle of wizards and warriors continues with Iron Sword. The evil wizard Malkiel will take the shape of the earth, wind, water, and fire.
Farewell! The fate of the world is in your hands! Back, Fire Beast!
And the jumping mechanics are a little bit more tighter. You still don't want to do a lot of sword play. You kind of generally want to run away and just get to point A to point B, because that's probably how you're going to survive this game, because it has limited continues once you get to a certain point, which is really stupid.
But it's very frustrating. This game is super frustrating, which is a shame because it's got a lot of cool things going for it. But they just kind of messed it up. One with the damage, and the continues get stripped away after three levels. It says four, I think, in the manual, but I read somewhere within the programming that messed up, and it's actually only three levels. After the third level, you're dead. You're done, no continues, back to the beginning. Boom.
It's good game of the three. Not much nostalgia on it though. The corner store that we had always rented games from actually only had Wizards and Warriors, so never got to experience number two until way later in life when we picked it up. Just on a whim.
I did finally just recently beat it for the first time, probably the only time I'll ever beat it, because I'd love to say I'd go back and play it once in a while, but I don't know, man. I'll stick to the first game.
The fate of the world is in your hands!
The fate of the world is in your hands! Back, Fire Beast!
Back, Fire Beast!
Kuros?
Fuck this game.
Oh, great Dragon King, I have brought back thee the golden crown thou hast asked for.
I changed my mind. I don't want it. It's too small for my head anyways. I want something else.
Change your mind? I went to a volcano to get the thing. Okay, well, what do you want, O large great lizard?
I want a snack. A good one.
Well, it's not like we have a wizard mart around here or something. Sure you don't want this crown? It's gold, I think.
I want a princess. They taste great and have low calories, so it's okay for me to have.
Excuse me?
Bring me Griselda and Candida. They look good.
What?
Listen, little buddy. I'm trying to slim down to get a date with a lady dragon two towns over. You gonna help me or what?
So you're on a diet? But there are better ways to lose.
Bring forth the princess mage.
The events after the battle at Nightstar Mountain are a bit hazy. Most legends say that my master did battle with Malkil soon after in Pedup, but they would be wrong. After defeating Malkil for a second time, my master Kuros went on a long sabbatical. He had made many friends and allies during this time, and it was time to party. But alas, after many years, Malkil has returned again. And this time he has captured the beauteous Princess Elaine and taken her to the forest of Xanifer. There, his place of death awaits, the dreaded Fortress of Fear.
There was a Game Boy game for Wizards and Warriors. Wizards and Warriors X, the Fortress of Fear.
So Wizards and Warriors, the Fortress of Fear, Chapter X, Chapter 10, is this the 10th installment? What happened to, 4 to 9?
This was a little bit of an offshoot from the main series. Instead of being able to progress in any way you wanted to, being able to just jump up to different platforms, progressing higher, it was a basic side-scrolling game. And it had 5 different worlds with each a set amount of levels, equivalent to 18 levels in total, I believe.
So essentially, this is the really straight-up, straightforward, linear platform, or action platform, moving basically left to right, sometimes right to left.
This one was not people's favorite at all. I don't think very many people enjoyed this game. It came out back in 1990. Again, I didn't play it until later on. I played it much later than when I played the original series. I was about 13 years old when I actually finally played this game.
But you're out to kill Malkil once again. I do believe he's captured your princess. There's another cliche for you.
So it was a straight-ahead platformer. You had no continues. It was a tough difficulty. Your character sprite was very slow, and the enemies were really fast, so you were just destined for doom.
The swordplay, I will say, is a little bit better, especially when you're crouching and you're actually, trying to stab guys. It's okay.
And the platforming was not well designed at all. I remember that there were these moving platforms that they'd be in very odd locations. Some would actually drop below the screen, and you were expected to just take a leap of faith and just hope to land on this platform that would drop down below, and you would actually fall down below the screen. So it was just very challenging, especially for, a handheld system.
This game's kind of a bugger, because once you get into the later dungeons, it's like enemies are positioned in exact spots where you're going to be jumping, jumping over a pit, boom, there's a snake guy, there's a snake enemy, or there's a knight with a throwing axe, boom, dead, So that's kind of cheap, and that kind of sucks.
I actually have very fond memories of it. I remember I was about 13 years old when I finally played this game, and I was going on a camping trip, and I didn't have the game, but I had the Game Boy. However, one of my friends had this game, so, I kind of begged him to borrow this game. He's like, oh, I'm going on a very long weekend, and I got my Game Boy, but no new games to play. I gotta play this game. I remember playing the games when I was younger, the whole series. Oh, please let me play this game. So reluctantly, he let me borrow this game, and well, I'm glad he did, because I got to enjoy it. And I remember just spending the whole camping trip, by the fire, just hanging out with my Game Boy in hand, trying to play this game. And it was a difficult game. Again, the Game Boy didn't really have great lighting, so it did just trying to proceed, trying to make these leaps of faith in this game. But it was a great time for me. I never beat the game. I never got very far into it. It could be because I was just young and I wasn't very good at games. But it was still great just to be able to have it on your Game Boy, to be able to play it during the car rides, the long, treacherous car rides that you always just dredge. So having your Game Boy, having new games to play, that's a big thing for a kid.
It's not a bad game. It's an okay platformer that kind of gets lost in the shuffle. So really not much more to say about Fortress of Fear, unfortunately. It's okay.
And unfortunately, now that I remember, I left my Game Boy in my friend's car. And not only my Game Boy, but all of my games, which includes the game that I borrowed from my other friend. So there goes my Game Boy and all my games, and the game that I borrowed from him. So if you're watching this, buddy, well, Bob's got your game.
Dear Ratface, you two-timing pig, you promised to not only marry me, but my two sisters. How disgusting are you? Just because you wave around your staff, by the way, it ain't that big. Damn! You think you could brainwash me and my sisters to just give you anything you want? If I ever see your shadowy face and pied up again, I'll cut off both of your wizards and your warrior. Go to hell.
Time had passed, and my master Kuros wandered aimlessly along the land. It was here that he came to find the city of Pedup, the largest city in the realm, bursting with people and secrets. Many secrets. The arts of thievery and magic were now at the fingertips of my master, but word from the people had spread. Malkil controls Pedup upon the seat of the former king. Worst yet, he has imprisoned the king's three beauteous princesses. The final battle of Kuros begins here, with the fate of time itself in the balance.
Ah, so Wizards and Warriors 3, Visions of Power, Visions of Kuros, Kuros, Visions of Power, however you want to call it. This one is super ambitious. It almost feels like a Super Nintendo game.
Interesting game. I never even knew this game existed. It was given to me in a lot of games by a friend years ago. And I went to reorganize my little collection and I came upon it and I said, Wizards and Warriors 3? I was like, I didn't know that they made a third one. And I loved the first one. This was actually before I even played Iron Sword, I think. So I threw it in and I have to say, I dig this game. I really think it was an ambitious game. I applaud them for what they tried to do. The three characters kind of on the fly switching off and on was neat.
I remember it. I got it from an old dear friend. Brandon, he had it in his collection, and when he kind of was getting rid of his NES library, which was like a stack of games, you know, starting from the floor all the way up to almost the ceiling, he actually gave us a big box of NES games, and, you know, between roller games and some other ones, and there was a lot of them, Mission Impossible, Wizards and Warriors 3 was among them.
But Visions of Power, this was that big leap for the franchise. This kind of took this series and really pushed it for a new generation of gamers. It really was inspired by Metroid, that Metroidvania style gameplay, because this had an open world concept. Yes, it was still a platformer, but you were exploring all around and you would proceed through the game as you chose to. You weren't, you know, designed to go through one stage to the next. You got to pick where you wanted to go.
So you're basically a warrior who can then learn to be a wizard, who can then learn to be a thief. Wizards and warriors are thieves.
The guild system, kind of the leveling up and the obstacle courses were fun. Very colorful. Again, a huge upgrade from the first game. Looks great.
You could be a thief, you could be, you know, the warrior, you could be the wizard. And you had, you could like get trophies to get into the guilds, and then you had to pass these tests so that you could level up. Each character had like its own skills to get past certain points in the game, or to use it and combine the two or the three.
But that open feeling of exploration, that was what really attracted me to this game. Just being able to, you would find new items and abilities, and that would be what you would use to proceed through this game to unlock different areas. That was what I thought was always really cool.
Not an easy game. I did play through it, and from what I remember, not easy. Not anything like Iron Sword, but a pretty good challenge.
And I actually really liked this game a lot when I popped it in the very first time when we were playing it. And I remember trying to beat it so bad, but it's very cryptic.
A lot of the game, you're collecting gems, and buying new keys to open new doors to locations that you're not too sure where they're going. There's all these doors all over the place, and you're not sure which one to go into. But that was the design of it, was to be that open concept. So you had that choice. You know, maybe I'll go to this location.
But you also have to find gems by finding the princesses that are locked away in various cryptic different points throughout the levels. And so they bestow upon you these gems that'll get you into the last area if you promise to marry them, so that's fun.
By far my favorite part of this game is the fact that there is an inn called the Naughty Damsel. There you have it.
And at the end of level, that was the best part of this game, because you were climbing this giant golden tower, and visually, it was just so cool to see this, having this huge tower that you have to climb and just jump over these different platforms, and you got to this point where you just couldn't proceed anymore, you couldn't jump any higher, so you're trying to think, oh, what do I do? And you're like, oh, wait a minute, you turn into a mage, and you would just sit there, and you would hover up to the top of the tower, and that was just mind-blowing. It was so cool to have.
Overall, really great music. Probably my second favorite Wizards and Warriors game, first one being the best one. But the third one is actually really good, really solid. Of the three, I still say the original was my favorite, but number three comes very close. So, just because I love the ambition, it seems like it's a living, breathing, almost world, in a sense. It's a big, really, really big adventure, so... Visions of Power is an awesome game.
You know, I do recommend this game series. I really do. Despite some of its flaws, despite some of the difficulty, you know, the platforming can be a little bit tricky. You know, you're constantly falling and dying, and, you know, all the enemies. It does have a very nice variety of enemies, which is nice. But despite all those flaws, there's a lot of enjoyment to get out of this game.
Overall, my thoughts on the whole series as a whole, amazing series of games. You know, when you think about the NES didn't have a lot of trilogies, albeit Mega Man had 6.
You know, you feel like a true knight. You know, you're a true treasure hunter. You get to save the princess. I mean, that's all we want out of our video games.
Wow, there's actually 3 games on that console, and each one actually is very good under its own merit. So, I mean, there's a little bit of a series and a franchise, you know, that maybe players of my demographic and age remember fondly, obviously. Turos was even on cartoon Video Power, so, I mean, that's saying something at least. So,
yeah, it was great being here. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it. You can find me on Wormy's Playhouse on YouTube, or follow me on Twitter, Drucifer89.
I love the franchise, and Kuros kicks ass.
So be sure to like this video and subscribe, and comment down below on what you enjoy about the Wizards and Warriors games.
So you got the whole wizard and the warrior thing going.